Anders Johan Lexell was an 18th century Finnish-Swedish astronomer, physicist, and mathematician. He spent the majority of his working life in St. Petersburg, Russia, known under the name Andrei Ivanovich Lexell, and worked quite closely with Leonard Euler, Euler holding Lexell in high regard. Lexell is notable for being one of the most prolific members of the Russian Academy of Sciences in St. Petersburg, having published 66 papers in the 16 years he was there, his work in spherical geometry, with a theorem being named after him, and his contributions to celestial mechanics, with a comet and asteroid also being named after him. Lexell was born on December 24th, 1740, in Åbo, a city on the southwest of Finland at the mouth of the Aura River. His father was Jonas Lexell, a goldsmith, jeweler, and local administrative officer in Åbo. His mother was Magdalena Katarina Björkegren, and she was related to the Wietfulth family, an important family of merchants that arrived from Germany and became naturalized in Åbo in the 17th century. Lexell was the oldest of five, having three sisters and a brother. Two of his sisters died relatively young, and the only surviving sister married a merchant whom she had 10 children with. Neither Lexell nor his brother ever married, so the male line of the Lexells in Finland died out. In 1750, Lexell's mother died while giving birth to his younger brother. Though this was quite a shock to the family, it could have been far worse had the family not had the kind of means they did. In 1756, at age 14, Lexell began attending the Academy of Obo. He appeared to be in the right place at the right time, as the professor, Martin Johan Wallenius, had just introduced infinitesimal calculus and modern mathematical physics to the scientific curriculum at the Academy, allowing Lexell to learn the latest developments in these subjects. Wallenius ended up supervising Lexell on his first printed work, titled Incidental Remarks on Leibniz's Universal Principle of Optics, as to its use in catoptrics. Leibniz's principle being one according to which light moves between two points along the easiest path. Lexell defended the paper on June 30th, 1759, and pointed out the failure of Leibniz's principle in the case of concave mirrors, using a few examples like spherical, parabolic, elliptic, and hyperbolic. Just 4 years after enrolling in the academy, Lexell received a PhD in philosophy. His dissertation was defended on June 4th, 1760, and was supervised by Jakob Gödelin, a Swedish Lutheran bishop who was a professor of physics at the academy. The thesis was titled Aphorismi Mathematico-Physici, consisting of 12 short essays on mechanics that mainly dealt with principles governing simple machines. Lexell was granted his PhD on August 28, 1760, and it appears that he had trouble finding work in academia after receiving his degree. There were no roles available at the Academy of Åbo at the time, so Lexell tutored privately for wealthy families to make ends meet. He was able to research differential and integral calculus diligently during this time, and prepared a paper titled On a Method of Determining Curves from a Given Property of the Radii of Curvature, which he presented at Uppsala University in Sweden in February 1763. Lexell stayed in Uppsala for a bit in hopes of getting a position, but ended up returning to Åbo. Further attempts at getting a professor position at Uppsala were denied. In September 1763, he was able to get a position as a mathematics lecturer at the Academy of Åbo. And in May 1765, he was also granted the position of adjunct professor in philosophy at the Academy. Lexell was a huge fan of Euler's work and wanted to find some way of working with him. Euler was at the Royal Academy of Science in St. Petersburg at the time, which required a paper submittal of original research to become a member. So Lexell began working on a paper to send off, titled Method of Analyzing Some Differential Equations Illustrated with Examples. The paper introduced a more refined version of reduction of order for differential equations. On January 14th, 1768, Lexell wrote a letter to Per Wilhelm Wargentin, a distant relative of Lexell's that was an influential Swedish astronomer, as well as a secretary at the Royal Academy of Sciences in St. Petersburg. And it's speculated in this correspondence that Lexa was tipped off that there may be an available position in St. Petersburg. On March 21st, 1768, Lexa's paper was read at a conference at the Royal Academy by Euler. The paper having been submitted by August Ludwig von Schlutza, a German historian and member of both the St. Petersburg and Swedish Royal Academies of Science. It's speculated that Vargentin sent Schlutza the paper, or Vargentin at least recommended Lexel send it off to him. Euler, thoroughly impressed and giving the paper high praise, recommended Lexel come to Russia to study mathematics and its application to astronomy. He felt Lexel would be of great help for the observation of the 1769 transit of Venus, and they needed competent astronomers and mathematicians for this. But Euler also felt that Lexel could keep up with his remarkable productivity. The position Vargentin had hinted at being available was given to someone else, so they had to create a position for Lexel. Count Vladimir Orlov, the director of the Royal Academy at the time, invited Lexel to the Royal Academy as an adjunct professor in mathematics, to which Lexel graciously accepted. But he had to wait a bit to leave, as he needed permission from the Swedish king to leave the country for Russia, arriving in St. Petersburg at the end of October 1768. Upon arriving there, Lexel had to immediately begin prepping for the transit of Venus that was to take place a few months later. Thus, he had to quickly grow familiar with the astronomical instruments that were to be used in the observation. When it was finally time to observe, Lexel did so with Christian Meyer, a Moravian-German astronomer and Catholic priest, hired by the Royal Academy to work at the observatory while Russian astronomers went to the other 8 observation sites. The importance of the transit was that astronomers could theoretically find the distance between Earth and the Sun from this event. Lexel published his results on this distance in 1771, his method being that of Euler's. Seeing as there were other astronomers with other methods who also observed the transit, there were disagreements from the likes of Anders Planman, a Finnish astronomer, physicist, and mathematician, Jérôme Lalonde, a French astronomer, Freemason, and writer, and Maximilian Hell, a Hungarian astronomer and ordained Jesuit priest. Disagreements escalated into a brutal dispute, largely between Lexel and Hell. In letters and even books, the two were harshly critical of one another. Hell suspicious of the methods used by Lexel and Euler, thinking his own were simply impeccable, and Lexel's writings trying to prove Hell's claims were nonsense, exposing many inconsistencies in Hell's work. With the dispute's intensity ever growing, Lexel wrote to Vargentin, Planman, and Johann Bernoulli III, trying to convince them of the solidity of his arguments, but there was still speculation. This basically went on until 1775, when Lexel published his final results and tried to leave this work behind him. The transit wasn't the only bit of frustration Lexel had to deal with. On August 21st, 1769, Christian Meyer observed a comet, and it was observed again on September 4th. Euler and Lexel began working on computing its orbit almost immediately. They first attempted to match the most reliable observation with the hypothesis of a parabolic orbit. Next, they extended their investigation to include other kinds of conic sections, with the possibility of there being elliptic orbits, with a certain error margin, that satisfied the positions on August 21st and September 4th. They then estimated the true orbit as the one that satisfies the comet's position on October 24th. Upon showing their results, the calculations were heavily criticized, leading to a rather frustrated Lexel. Of course, this didn't challenge Lexel's merit in the scientific community too heavily, as he was still yielding very strong work, like his work on the orbit of another comet, observed by Charles Messier on June 4th, 1770. Lexel ended up working very hard to calculate the orbit of this comet, and even though Messier was the first to observe it, the comet ended up being named after Lexel. Lexel actually spent 8 years working on the calculations, presenting his work on October 24th, 1778. In Reflections on the Periodic Time of Comets in General, mainly on that of the comet observed in 1770. His work concluded the comet was thrown into a temporary orbit after a close encounter with Venus, and that after completing 2 revolutions, it would probably be ejected into a different orbit in its re-encounter with Jupiter in 1779. Lexel was right on target, and the comet has not been seen since. The mathematics in the work posed many difficulties as it involved attracting two bodies at the same time, the Sun and Jupiter, with the mass of Jupiter relative to the Sun being unknown. A general solution to this problem has become reasonably manageable only recently thanks to modern age computing power. Lexel is also the one to conclude that the observation of yet another comet was actually the observation of a new planet. Friedrich Wilhelm Herschel, a musician and astronomer living in England, observed what would be named Uranus on March 13, 1781. He wrote to the Royal Society on April 4th about the object he saw, and the discovery of a comet, coined King George's Star, was announced on April 26, 1781. Lexel was in London at the time, so he was amongst the first to hear about it. Due to his previous work on orbits and the data available from the observations, Lexel quickly concluded that the orbit conformed approximately to a circle, thus moving like that of a distant planet and thus not a comet. Upon his return to St. Petersburg in late 1781, and analyzing work done by Bode, Meyer, and Vargentin, Lexel was able to calculate the exact orbit, helping him estimate the size of the planet. And it must be noted that Lexel and Euler were actually discussing its orbit on the day of Euler's death. Now, from its orbit, Lexel was also able to conjecture that there could exist other more distant planets, and the size of the solar system could very well extend several hundred Earth-Sun distances. There were a few suggestions for the name of this planet, such as Georgian Planet, Neptune, Platinum, and Uranus. And ultimately Uranus won, though England referred to it as the Georgian Planet until about 1850. The last contribution we'll discuss is a theorem from spherical geometry that was actually named after him. His paper containing it was published in 1784, titled Solution to a Problem of Geometry in the Theory of the Sphere. And the theorem is stated as follows. On the surface of the sphere, the line in which are situated the vertices of all the triangles having the same base and the same surface area is a small circle of the sphere. He proved it both analytically and geometrically. Jakob Steiner, a Swiss mathematician, mainly geometer, pointed out in an 1841 paper of his that Lexel's theorem was generally known only through Legendre in his work Elements of Geometry, and it was given in an incomplete manner. Every author who referenced this theorem for some time seemed to have done the same. It wasn't until Joseph Liouville, a mathematician notable for his contributions to topology and complex analysis, that this error was fixed. He had reviewed Lexel's paper, which was stored in the Paris Royal Academy of Sciences, and recognized it was the complete proposition that Legendre mutilated. Steiner was even more dumbfounded by the fact that this error persisted, considering there was a 1797 posthumous paper from Euler that also contained this theorem with a rather elegant proof provided. In 1775, the Swedish king appointed Lexel to the chair of mathematics at the Academy of Åbo. The king granted him permission to stay in Russia for 3 more years to wrap up his work. This ended up being prolonged 2 more years to 1780. Sergei Gerasimovich Domashnev, the director of the Royal Academy of Science at the time, did not want to lose Lexel, so he proposed Lexel go traveling to learn mainly about the cutting-edge techniques other astronomers were using. An absolutely exciting prospect for Lexel, as it was quite rare for academicians to be sent abroad at the time. The suggested places were Germany, England, and France, with a return to St. Petersburg via Sweden. This gave Domashnev time to ensure Lexel wouldn't have to actually go back to Sweden. Before leaving, Lexel had to write up an itinerary of things he'd need for the trip, and Domashnev signed off on his itinerary without any change requests. A more detailed aim for the trip was as follows. Learn how other observatories were built, note the number and types of scientific instruments used, if something new and interesting were found by the plans and design drawings, learn everything about cartography, try to get new geographic, hydrographic, military, and mineralogic maps, and lastly, write letters to the Academy regularly to report interesting news on science, the arts, and literature. Now we'll give a brief rundown of his travels. In July of 1780, Lexel left St. Petersburg to go to Berlin. In August 1780, he headed to Potsdam, actively seeking a meeting with King Frederick II of Prussia. In September of 1780, Lexel left Potsdam for Bavaria, visiting Leipzig, Göttingen, and Mannheim along the way. In October of 1780, he traveled to Strasbourg and then Paris, spending the entire winter there. Come March of 1781, Lexell moved on to London, where he would stay through the summer. In August of 1781, Lexell traveled to Belgium, visiting Flanders and Brabant, before making his way to the Netherlands, visiting The Hague, Amsterdam, and Saardam along the way. From there, Lexell returned to Germany, visiting Hamburg, before making his way to Kiel to board a ship to Sweden. In October 1781, Lexell spent time in Åbo visiting family and colleagues, as well as going to visit Stockholm, Uppsala, and the Åland Islands. And finally, in December 1781, Lexell returned to St. Petersburg, ending a year and a half of travels. Alas, the official reports written to Domashnev on the trip have been lost, but there are around 30 letters addressed to Johann Euler that are archived at the Royal Academy of Science, which contain detailed descriptions of places and people who were met on Lexell's travels, as well as the impressions they had on him. On December 11, 1784, Lexell had an operation to remove a tumor. 2 days later, Lexell died due to complications most probably from infection that caused a severe fever. He was buried in St. Petersburg soon after. Now, when it comes to the history books, Russia marked Lexell as a Russian academician, and Finland simply referred to him as an expat who was the chair of Åbo, but did not exert any significant influence on conditions of learning. So initially, he wasn't fully understood nor appreciated in his native country. His lack of influence in Finland can be easily contested in letters written at the time, of course. For instance, Lexell's successor to the Åbo chair, Johan Henrik Lindqvist, pursued several problems in his dissertations that were initially addressed by Lexell. And at one point, Lexell offered half of his salary for the acquisition of modern astronomical instruments for Åbo, clearly showing his efforts to improve the conditions of learning at the academy. The instruments contributed are actually amongst the oldest scientific instruments at the University of Helsinki, the historic successor of Åbo. Now, to discuss Lexell's character a bit, he was earnest and had total commitment to the scientific mission, very dedicated to whatever research he jumped into. But he was susceptible and introspective as well, and he was remarkably distrustful. During the Transit of Venus debacle, his views towards Lalande, Hell, Planman, and even Johann Bernoulli III were largely provoked by his own lack of self-confidence in difficult situations, rather than ill will or negligence on the part of his adversaries. Letters also reveal that Lexell was not afraid of confrontation, could be quite temperamental when it came down to it, and he suffered from a guilty conscience with respect to his words and actions after the fact. He also seemed to be quite religious. He expected honesty and sincerity from those around him, as he viewed these as essentially Christian values. He felt that God was the absolute source of everything true and good. And going further down that road, he felt that God was the judge of what is just and appropriate for every man. Thus, no one could attempt anything he is unworthy of without incurring God's wrath. He also liked labeling those who did not stick to solid facts or flawless reasoning as charlatans. His religious views also extended into his political views, feeling that wars and misrule were the fault of the monarchs that defied God's holy word. As mentioned, Lexell never married and thus never had any children. And not much can be said from his writings. He never mentioned having thought of marrying, not even desiring anyone. He did, however, make one remark in a letter to Johann Euler on being single. "We preach against being single, and it is right to condemn those who are so without any necessity. But there are many in number who are so because they would render themselves and their families unhappy by taking a wife. Though I probably spent the biggest and the best part of my life single, I only can think with regret about the necessity for me to be so even in the future, as much from consideration as for economic reasons." Well, there you have it, a brief history of Anders Johann Lexell, a man who became known as Euler's closest associate, one of the few at the time who could actually understand Euler's reasoning, and a man who became internationally known, especially so during his travels from 1780 to 1781. alas, not being able to bask in it for too long as he would die at the end of 1784. I'd like to give a special thanks to J.T. Nyberg for mentioning Lexell to me. I hadn't stumbled upon him during my early research for some reason, and it's pretty cool to know how close he was to him. And lastly, thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed, and I'll catch you in the next video.